We have to deal with things that go on two different planes. We deal with the horizontal and we deal with the vertical. The vertical is our relationship with God. And there are going to be decisions we have to make that are, I mean, every decision we make in one way or another is going to affect that relationship. Every choice we make is going to leave a ripple. There is no choice we make that doesn't. Regardless of how little or seemingly inconsequential that choice is, our lives are defined by choices. Those choices, in essence, reveal to us where we really stand on something and what's really important to us. They reveal to us, in essence, they will support us, if we're really being truthful, normally with ourselves on these areas. And they also, by the way, convict us, or at least stand as testimony against us when we really try to say something, you know, and it doesn't come to pass. If you know, for a person to say, God is the most important thing in my life, and then and then the choices we make really just contradict that we choose the things that hate God, we are indifferent to the things that are important to God, we are, in essence, lackadaisical about the things that could draw us closer in a relationship to God, and we're in hot pursuit, on the other hand, of things that aren't, well, then that becomes clear that even though no matter what we say in testimony and verbal testimony, our choices really become evidence of the truth. And unfortunately, because we're such good liars, and I'm not talking just about myself, I believe every one of us are. I believe that we're all fantastic liars to the one person that gives audience to our lives more than anyone, that's ourselves. And that's why Jeremiah tells us that our heart is desperately wicked, and even scarier yet, it tells us deceitful above all things. Now, if your heart is deceitful, in other words, untruthful, above everything else, that means my heart is even more lying and deceitful than Satan. Boy, have a nice day, be warmed and filled. Aren't you great? We're not ending there. But can you love God and make a stupid choice? Sure. Can you get caught in that stupid choice so that it, in essence, spirals into a handful of other choices? Now understand, the moment you start taking a step away from God, the moment you start taking a step away from God, every choice you make after that point has to be a braver and a graver step to step back. Not because you're farther away from God as far as He's concerned, but because now you've made a practice of this bad choice. And the moment it becomes a lifestyle, you know this. Like, for instance, let's just kind of play this out for a second. I don't want to use anyone in the room because that would be kind of scary under these circumstances. But let's say there's a guy named Bob. And Bob, by the way, he's a Christian, you know, he's been pursuing God, but he meets this girl, Thelma, because I don't know anyone in our fellowship named Thelma, so we're pretty safe at the moment. You know what's going to happen on Sunday. And you're like, oh, she's Thelma. Well, so she meets Thelma, and Thelma's really, you know, he says that God's the most important thing, and he's looking for a godly woman. And he meets Thelma. And when he meets Thelma, she has no interest in God. She doesn't read, she doesn't pray, she doesn't do anything, she doesn't go to church. But she's fine. She's cute. And Bob is really drawn to her, and he starts pursuing a relationship with her. Now, which one of you out there wants to tell him the obvious truth? Now, let's face it. From a black and white perspective, we can look and say, bro, I know what you've said is that the most important thing for you is a godly woman. But what's clear is the most important thing to you is a cute woman, because that's the one thing this girl's got, because she ain't got none of that God stuff going on. Because you know what happens when you do that. On matters of the heart, you actually put yourself, you become the opponent on a moment like that, let's be honest. So what happens is, at that moment, in the beginning, it's like, no, no, no. And you know how that usually works, especially when you know your friends aren't going to approve. They start telling you things like, no, 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 no. We're just co-workers, but they don't really work together. But they, yeah, I don't know, you know. Or, well, you don't understand. You know, it's like, we like to go to the library together, and it's coincidental. I'm like, bro, you've never been to the library in your life. Now all of a sudden you're in the library all the time. I didn't even know you knew how to read, you know. And so you kind of know right from that moment that, you know, the habits are starting to change. But at that moment, if he just, you know that if he just kind of says, you know what, really, we got to really put some tapers on this relationship because I want you to know I'm not pursuing you any form of romantic way. Well, I mean, that's kind of weird. But then it gets more intense. And as they start to become more casual with each other, they start to get closer. And then it's really convenient. And as it becomes convenient, they start kissing. And as they start kissing, now it's a much bigger choice to make. Because now you realize, now you got to look at somebody you kissed and say, we really should, you know, I really shouldn't go out with you because I'm a Christian. That's going to go over really well. So, you know, what happens is you realize that's kind of a big step. So, well, I don't know about that. So I'm just going to kind of write it out because obviously the wave you're surfing is going to lead you to something good because you've been going from bad to worse. And right? Well, that doesn't make any sense. But that's the way, because we're still lying to each other. Now we're becoming addicted to it. So what happens next? Now you guys are getting really close. And then she moves in and they move in together. Now, you know what happens in a moment like that? At that point, he knows he's probably not going to go to church anymore. Because if he goes to church, he is convinced that every person is going to look at him and with that, I told you so. You lied to yourself and I knew it. Right? And so you know that. So now, but sooner or later, somewhere in it, he starts to realize that his relationship is suffering with God. Of course, duh. We would have told him that before it started. And now he's in this really rough place. And you sit down with him and you tell him, bro, I thought Jesus was the most, you told me Jesus was the most important relationship in your life, and what you really wanted was a godly woman. He's like, yeah, but you don't understand. Do you realize how hard it's going to be now to make this right? Because every step you take in that direction makes it harder and graver and braver for you to take the step to make it right. Let's be honest. Well, David did the same thing. What David did is he made a choice that will affect the rest of his life. Now, when was the last time you thought that the choice you made today was going to affect the rest of your life? When you thought, well, you know, I think I'm going to get that energy drink, or I think that I'm going to go and eat at Five Guys, or, you know, I think I'll actually try to show up at work a little early today. Or, I mean, well, did you really think that any choice you were going to make today really was going to just change the rest of your life? Like, from this point on, I will look back at this moment and say, my whole life was redirected right there. Well, that was David. David was supposed to be at it, told us in the last chapter. It was the time when the kings go out to battle. God made that clear. He didn't just say it was spring and people fight. You know, I mean, and it's the weirdest thing. And to be honest, until I get here, this is weirder. Here, there's just this thing where you could be upset and something could happen and be like, hey, well, we'll rediscuss this tomorrow. You know, I mean, in America, they just keep going until they duke it out. Well, at least where I'm from. And the reason I say that is like they would fight and then the rainy season would come and then they're like, all right, well, interval, you know, it's intermission, and when the rain stops, I'll come back and we'll kill each other again. Okay, we'll have a good winter. Okay, you know, Merry Christmas, you know. And obviously, we're 1,000 years before. Anyways. And so, with all of that said, and then, you know, the reason I say that is it's spring. We've had time, and here's the point, is we've had time off. We've had time off from that battle, and we've had time off from that battle, but when the time comes now where everyone's getting up and fighting, except for the guy that's actually supposed to lead them. He's kind of like laying out. And that becomes the next step. That's the first step into a group of downward steps where each one becomes harder to make it right. But it started with the fact he was supposed to fight the Ammonites, and he didn't. Joab is out there. His men are out there. And of course, he sees the girl bathing, and he asks his servants, who dat? Which, of course, there's a problem there, of course. What in the world are you doing? David's got by at this point, like, he's got over 10 wives by this point, 11 wives. And it's like, I mean, that's more than one per day of the week. You know, I mean, anyways. And, you know, of course, his son's going to way outdo dad when that time comes. But you know, David kind of looks, and he's talking to servants. And the servants are like, oh, well, I'll go find out. Oh, hey, that's, by the way, the wife of your bodyguard. She's the granddaughter of your chief counselor. Oh, yeah, and she happens to be named Daughter of a Covenant. And David's like, oh, he doesn't hear any of that. He's like, well, get her. And, of course, the servants have two choices, do what the king says or die. So it's a little rough for them. So they get her, and David lays with her. And now look at the steps he's taken. Now, at that point, how do you get it right? And then she sends a message, assumedly a couple months later, because it isn't like, you know, unless she's like, I have woman's intuition. But chances are it's a couple months later where she's like, David, we've got a bigger problem, you know, and which is so sad. Because there are people who spend their whole life trying to have a child and they can't. And then there are other people who they get pregnant and it's a problem. You know, I know friends that were botched abortions. Their parents tried to kill them. And they're like, well, I'm glad the doctor failed. Some of them, by the way, they will spend at least 2 to 3 trips to the GP every week just to basically try to live a somewhat normal life because of the things they experienced in the attempt to kill before they were born. But imagine being born and the first thing, you know, it's like, you know, you were a problem. You were a problem from the beginning. Imagine that weirdness, that weird dynamic. You know, things would have been so much better had you not been born. I remember hearing that. I hear that a lot. It's a weird dynamic. So now David's got another issue. He's got a pregnant girl that happens to be a bodyguard who's obviously a trained killer. And that's his wife. Now how do you make it right? And I wonder how far you get into this before you look and go, man, I just wish that I hadn't made those stupid choices to start with. So then he goes and has brings the husband to try to get him to sort of make it look like he did it. And he's too noble. And ultimately he has him killed. And now he kills her husband. And he has him killed. And this was a guy that's after God's own heart. Now look it. Yes, it is. But the moment you start taking steps down the slippery slope of this kind of sin, or any kind of sin, to be honest, and you don't want to make it right early, each step is harder. Not because of God, but because it's become a habit now. Now the guy is dead. But David had said, by the way, when I kept silent, my bones grew old. My vitality dried up like the drought of summer. I mean, we need to recognize David was not okay. He might have appeared to be okay, but David wasn't okay. And he was getting old, and he was getting old really, really quick from the inside. So finally, God, in his love for David, has to rescue David, because there's no way David has the strength, as mighty as he was, the tens of thousands that he would take down to the Philistines. He wasn't strong enough to make himself right anymore. It's just like this. Where we lived in California, we would often get what's called a riptide. Now, a riptide is a countertide to the waves. It's actually this strange current that pulls you out to sea. On certain days, we'd have these days called red tide. Red tide mean there was a specific type of plankton, or if you will, a specific type of kelp that would kind of come in. It was kind of corrosive. It would kind of burn a bit, especially in your eyes. And bad days to surf. But it would, with that red tide would often come. It was a sign. It was a great sign that at that point, it was not a day to go out, because unless you were a really good surfer, because no doubt, or a good swimmer, because no doubt you were going to get pulled out. And you kind of knew if you stepped in on a day like that, you were going to fight that current from the moment you stepped in. And all you had to do was relax and let it happen. And the next thing you know, you're a mile out from shore. And I don't know if you realize, that is a long way to swim. Especially when the current hasn't stopped pulling you out. So now you're actually trying to get that mile. Plus, you have to fight the current that you have now put yourself in the middle of. Well, that's what sin is. It is a riptide. And what happens is you get to that place where now you're so far from where you want to be, and God recognizes when you're like, David is never going to be able to swim back to shore at this point. So God goes in after him. Aren't you thankful in a moment like that? And he sends Nathan the prophet, who lays out a story of a similar nature, a parable, and David, of course, throws out his judgment on it, and his judgment on it was without mercy. And that was where, at least if you look at your handout, it starts, by the way, with Nathan's response, and this is to cap up for context. It says in 2 Samuel 12:5, David's anger was greatly aroused against the man in the story, and Nathan, the prophet, says, "As the Lord lives," David responds, "the man who has done this shall surely die, and he shall restore fourfold for the lamb because he did this thing and he had no pity." No pity was the, and it's an interesting phrase. It, in essence, it means he lost his heart. Now, I bet every one of you has this. I can certainly tell you I do. Certain things that when I find myself in the middle of it, I just lose my heart. It's like I have to shut my heart off to stay there. You know, places where when you first started, your heart bothers you. It's part of your conscience going, hey, you really shouldn't be here. You know what they're saying is destructive to people you love, or you know that what this is really going to pull you away from the Lord. You know you're not in a good place. You know this is going to drag. You know that there's a riptide here. You know this is going to drag you away from safety. You know that. You know that. And you're like, no, I'm stronger. I'm cool. And somewhere down the line, you have to shut that off. David looks at this story, and he goes, oh, that guy was heartless by the time this thing was done. Verse 13, Nathan says, well, you know, Nathan actually says, you're the man. You don't realize that this the guy you're speaking about is yourself, David. And David's response in verse 13 is, I've sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said, the Lord has put away your sin. You're not going to die. But because of this deed that you have given, great occasion for the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child who was born is going to die. Now, notice when he says this, it seems like the child's already born. It doesn't say the child who is going to be born. It says the child, you already have had time with this child, David, but he's going to die. And what I want to point out as we go through this text is God forgives, but sin still leaves ripples. Those choices are still going to bear forth fruit, whether we like it or not. Now, there is warning in that, but I want to warn you. Because of the things that take place in this chapter, you might find yourself on one side or the other, and either extreme is a dangerous one. So pray with me really quick, and we'll start talking about these results. Lord, I pray again, open our hearts. Open our hearts, Lord, so that what you want to speak to us individually, we could hear. And open us as a family, Lord, because we want to be led by you to do what you call us to here. We want to make the changes that were necessary, that are necessary, regardless of how grave and how brave. Because we really do want to make you the number one thing. Well, let our choices reflect that in Jesus' name. Amen. David has already shown us three results between his interaction and his psalms. One is that his soul suffered. In other words, you erode. Now, and I got to be honest, I put myself in David's shoes. He's a songwriter, you know, he's a passionate guy, he was a fighter. All the things that I've, you know, the fighting thing has been, praise God, laid to rest. But it's like I find myself very, you know, I liken myself a lot to what I read about David. And the reason I say that is there's a part of me that wonders when David started writing this and he said, you know, that my bones grew old, my vitality was dried up because your hand was heavy on me. And I read that and I got to be honest, there's a part of me that reads that and thinks if I were David at that moment, I would be so bummed because I'd think, oh, God, why wasn't I this miserable without you having to make me this miserable? I mean, if I really love you and I really am passionate about you the way I should be, and I know that there have been times I've been like that, why wasn't I suffering for these choices just because I knew they were wrong? Why did your hand have to be heavy on me to make me feel this bad? Not blaming God, but blaming me. I'm like, I should have been this miserable without your help just because this was so wrong. But then remember what David said about the man in the story. He said he did this without pity. He did this and he shut off his heart. He lost his heart to do this. And you could see David go, man, that is me. I mean, for me to keep doing this, I cannot have a real tender heart and keep doing this. Because either I really have to bite into and fully buy the lie that, God, you are everything I claim, but I'm not living like it. Or I got to man up and realize, man, I've been living a lie because I've been just playing this game where it's verbal, but my choices are clearly so contrary to that. But as what Nathan said here, that you've given great occasion for the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, not only does his soul suffer, but David gave the adversary ammo. Ammo is a short for ammunition. And you know this. There are people out there that really don't want to believe in God. They'd love all the things of God. They just don't want to believe in one that they have to actually submit to. That's always the problem, is a lordship issue. You know, hey, I'm happy to take God if he's going to bail me out of jail and he's going to bail me out of hell and he's going to bless me and give me stuff. But if he tells me what to do, we're going to have a problem. Well, you got to receive God for who he is. And the reason I say that is those people that are out there that don't want to receive the Lord, they're looking to see Christians be like everyone else. If we are really starkly different as God calls us to than the rest of the world, it is in their face the evidence that God displays through that. And this is why he tells us to do things very contrary to the world around us. And we will go, oh yeah, but the world around, well, we need to be more like them. And God goes, stop being like them. Because if you're like them, the rest of the world says, well, they're no different. And what Nathan is saying to David is, you know, your behavior has actually given bullets to the enemy to shoot at you. You're aware of that. And actually, worse yet, given bullets to shoot at me. Because the moment they think that we're just like the rest of the world, you know where that goes with it. The next conclusion of that is, well, then God's not real. If you guys are just like, if your divorce rate is just like the world's divorce rate, if you're shooting at everyone else like everyone else is shooting at everyone else, if you're indifferent about what it really means and you're not loving each other the way God tells us, which is to be selfless, and we tell people that we are born again and we are new creations, and they look and go, well, how are you new? And if we look just like everybody else, then they go, psh, well, then how do I know your God's real? You look like everyone else. And they have a right to do that if they're genuinely skeptical. But God will nail them, and that's not my job. I'm thankful for that. I just don't want to give the enemy any ammunition. And Nathan looks and he goes, you realize you've armed the adversary by your behavior. The moment a high-profile guy on television, and we're all aware of the fact most of those guys, I can't tell you they're saved or not, but they're definitely a circus. You know. And the moment one of those guys gets nailed for tax evasion or money laundering or some kind of crazy show, falls morally, the world really stands up and applauds it. Because they're like, see, told ya. They shouldn't exist. When I watched 9-1-1 happen, and then I had friends who live in Israel who were contacting me and saying, are you okay? Which is a funny thing to think. But they were showing me video of the Palestinians dancing in the streets, celebrating the destruction of 5,000 people. My heart just melted. It was like, I can't. That they could hate people they don't know that much because of their doctrines. Innocent people who went to work just like any other day had no idea that that would be the day they faced God because of it. Because they really don't want America, and they don't want, you know, we know this, they don't want England. You guys, we here are the little Satan. America's a bigger Satan. I think it's just because we have more property over there. But in the end of it all, we're still Satan as far as these people are concerned. And I mean, it's just amazing when you start looking at a lot of this. But like anything that happens here causes that to celebrate, because they look and they say, look at that destruction, and that's what we're looking for anyways. And again, I'm not saying that every person there is that way, but I am saying that there is a whole group of people that are like that. And the adversaries of Christians are very much the same. Anything they see that causes infighting and separation and all that stuff, they just love it. And especially when you see something like this, and how much more profile could you get than David? So his soul was suffering and gave the adversary ammo. But the other thing was, it says here in verse 14 that the child born to you will surely die. He lost his legacy. And I find this interesting. We forfeit our fruit when we start to choose sin. Let me say that again. We forfeit our fruit when we start to choose sin. You know what's interesting? Who was the first person who sinned in Scripture? Well, let me say this way. Who's the first person who sinned according to knowledge? Adam. Eve actually was genuinely deceived. 1 Timothy makes that clear. In other words, she sinned, but she sinned ignorantly. Adam, on the other hand, he was fully aware of what the situation was. He was fully conscious of the truth and made that choice. How many generations did it take before one of their children was murdered? Seemed like their first two. And one killed the other. Interesting how he forfeited fruit from that. On the other side of that, just before David was Saul. If you remember, Saul's choices in sin, that the first thing he did, one of the first things he lost, was that his son Jonathan, Saul's son Jonathan, would not be king as a result of it. He forfeited his fruit. And the moment we start choosing sin, we forfeit the fruit that God wants to bear through us, because we can only bear that fruit if we cling to Jesus, and we can't cling to Jesus and run after sin at the same time. We're going to try to, in essence, sever ourselves from Christ, although he won't leave us or forsake us. And in that, they try to run after something like that, but we're certainly not clinging to him. It's like a married couple living together, but they're nowhere near each other physically. They're not going to have any babies that way, and I'm not trying to get weird, but you get the idea. But there's more to it, because now that starts to roll out. But I want you to realize this can be a very challenging and a very encouraging text as we read the rest of this, but I think it's going to really point out where we are, how we address Scripture like this. So David now has been nailed, but God has forgiven him, but there's going to be fruit from those labors regardless. It's just not godly fruit. And I remind you, a good portion, at least half of the kids that David has, are adolescent. They're no dummies. They've got to be aware of what's going on here. Verse 15. Nathan departed from his house, I remind you, he told him that the child that was born to you guys, that child's going to die. And the Lord struck that child. Notice it says that Uriah's wife bore to David. Notice that God made note that Bathsheba in verse 15 is Uriah's wife. Did you notice that? Uriah, by the way, who was that? Well, that was her husband, the one that David had killed. And it became ill. David therefore pleaded with God for the child. The word pleaded is the word bakash, and it means to strive towards. In other words, David, with all of his might now, his passion is being all about begging God. And David fasted, and he went in and lay all night on the ground. So the elders of the house arose and went to him to raise him up from the ground, but he would not, nor did he eat with them. There comes a place when we are actually nailed in our sin, where we become impervious to any human consolation, and the only comfort we can find is in God, and God will allow that. But there becomes an issue we need to recognize here. There is a huge difference between hating the sin and hating the consequence. And it is important to note, if you hate the consequence, I mean, you should, because it's usually awful. The moment it lessens, you'll run back to the sin. But if you hate the sin, you'll do what is necessary to not get to it again. I knew a guy that had been arrested 11 different times for driving under the influence. And each time the consequences got more grave. Of course, it cost him more and so forth. And after a while, of course, he wound up driving without a license because they took it from him. But that 11th time, he nearly killed someone. And that really startled him and it freaked him out. But did he hate drinking and driving? Well, what would you do if you wanted to completely remove the possibility of that sin? Well, you can make two choices: never drive again or never drink again. Or if you don't do both, it's not possible either. The guy was like, well, and understand, I'm not trying to be a legalist, but for this guy, he needed to stay away because the guy couldn't have a drink without making it 20. And he's like, well, I'll drive on certain days, I'll drink on certain other days. But of course, you know that it's not going to work out. So the next time, he wound up killing someone. The problem was is that the consequences got more grave. But he never hated the sin. He just hated the consequences. And when you are in a place like this with David, David's consequences are pretty, well, they're literally grave. He as a child is going to die, and God promised him that. And David is pleading with God. The question is, if God says no to your pleas, do you worship him anyways? Is he really the thing you're looking for in this? Or are you just looking to make God the means to the end of making the situation easier? Does that make sense?